A very good morning to all our viewers. I'm Smriti Rastogi with Breakfast News. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines of the day. Election Commission announces date for presidential polls. Voting on 17th July, counting on 20th July. Last date for filing nominations on June 28th. Prime Minister to attend two-day Shanghai Cooperation Summit in Kazakhstan. India to be formally inducted into grouping along with Pakistan. SP and collector of Mandsaur in Madhya Pradesh transferred. State government sets up commission to ensure justified price for farmers. Rahul Gandhi to visit. Britain votes today in the general elections. Fight between Theresa May and Jeremy Corbyn polls in backdrop of terror attacks in the UK. And big day for India at the French Open. Rohan Bopanna and Canadian partner Gabriela Dabrowski to play title match in the mixed doubles. The Election Commission on Wednesday announced that the election to the post of president will be held on July 17th. Announcing the election schedule, the Election Commission said that it wanted the voting process to be completed before July 24th, the day when President Pranab Mukherjee completes his tenure. According to the Election Commission announcement, votes will be counted on July 20th. The date for issuing notification will be June 14th, while the last date for filing nomination is June 28th. Nominations will be scrutinized on June 29th, while the last date for withdrawal of nomination is July 1st. The Commission also warned parties against issuing whips regarding the elections. Election will take place through secret ballot. Following the ink controversy at the Rajya Sabha polls in Haryana last year, the Election Commission has decided to use special pens for the electors to mark their votes in the 17 July presidential election. The decision to use special pens is based on the recommendations made by a working group set up by the poll panel to suggest ways to avoid repeat of such disputes in future polls.
The term of office of Shri Pranab Mukherjee, President of India, is ending on 24th July. As per Article 62 of the Constitution, an election to fill the vacancy caused by the expiration of the term of office of the outgoing president is required to be completed before the expiration of the term. The Election Commission of India is mandated to ensure that the election to the office of the President of India, which is the highest elective office in the nation, must be free and fair, and the Commission is taking all necessary steps for discharging its constitutional responsibilities.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi will attend the two-day Shanghai Cooperation Organization Summit in Astana in the capital of Kazakhstan today. Ahead of his visit, the Prime Minister said that he looks forward to deepening India's association with the SCO. During the summit in Astana, India and Pakistan will become full members of the Eurasian grouping comprising at present China, Russia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan and Uzbekistan. The Prime Minister said that on completion of the process, India will become a full member of the SCO, upon which the SCO will represent over 40% of the humanity and nearly 20% of the global GDP. On the evening of June 9th, Prime Minister Modi will also attend the inauguration of the Astana Expo with the theme of Future Energy. In the 2015 summit in Ufa in Russia, the group had formally adopted a resolution which started the procedure to admit India and Pakistan in the SCO. Both countries signed memorandum of obligations to join the SCO last year. Prime Minister Narendra Modi is also expected to meet Chinese President Xi Jinping on the sidelines of the summit in a bid to stabilize ties.
The formal process of India joining has taken place, and as Joint Secretary mentioned, the Shanghai Secretariat of the organization has confirmed that it's been done. But since it's an organization, multilateral intergovernmental organization, the decision rests with the heads of state. So heads of state are going to meet, and the heads of state are expected to formally accept India's membership.
The Madhya Pradesh state government has transferred the SP and the collector of Mandsaur that saw large-scale violence in the ongoing farmers' protest. A contingent of RAF has also been deployed there. Public property was vandalized during Wednesday's protest. Despite curfew and suspended mobile internet services, the protest was widespread. As political row over the protest is gaining heat, Congress Vice President Rahul Gandhi and JDU leader Sharad Yadav will be visiting Mandsaur today.
The situation in MP's Mandsaur remained volatile on Wednesday, with farmers resorting to violence and arson despite curfew and prohibitory measures. Cellular services remained suspended in Ratlam, Neemaj, Mandsaur and Ujjain. The protesting farmers set ablaze 8 to 10 vehicles. The centre rushed 1,100 personnel of the Anti-Riot Rapid Action Force. Meanwhile, the statewide bund called by different parties and organisations has evoked mixed response.
किसानों जो दुर्दशा, किसानों की जो अभी हत्या हुई है, किसान जो हमारे जिनके किसानों की हत्या की है उसके संबंध में हम उनके सरकार के खिलाफ ये प्रदर्शन कर रहे हैं।
हम किसान हैं, हम किसानों का दुख दर्द जानते हैं, इसलिए सड़क पे खड़े हुए हैं। हम खुद किसान हैं, इसलिए ये आंदोलन कर रहे हैं।
कृषि के क्षेत्र में किसानों के हित में एक नई अनेक योजनाएं बनाई है। भारत सरकार और केंद्र सरकार के साथ साथ राज्य सरकार से जो जो योजनाएं बनी है उसमें किसानों के हित संरक्षण की बहुत सारी योजनाएं और उनको लाभान्वित किया जा रहा है।
Farmers who have been demanding debt relief and better prices for their crops since June 1st heckled Mandsaur collector and a superintendent of police when they tried to pacify them. The agitators are also demanding a visit from Chief Minister to Mandsaur. Chief Minister Shivraj Singh Chauhan has announced certain measures, including a loan settlement scheme for those cultivators who had defaulted on repayment of farm loan. He also announced a compensation of 1 crore rupees each for the next of the kin of the six farmers who were killed in firing and a government job for their family members. Chauhan has also ordered judicial inquiry into the matter. The blame game over the incident is on, with Union Minister M. Venkaiah Naidu blaming the Congress for instigating farmers and the opposition party holding the government responsible for farmers' plight.
मध्य प्रदेश में मंदसौर इलाके में फायरिंग के कारण से किसान मर गए, ये बहुत दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण बात है। कांग्रेस वाले इसको राजनीतिक रूप देके वहां हिंसा को प्रेरित करने के लिए प्रयास किया।
हमेशा बीजेपी की राजनीतिक रणनीति रहती है कि जहां वे कोई जवाब नहीं दे पाए, जहां वो कहीं सफाई नहीं दे पाते, ये कहते हैं ये विरोधी दल इसका कर रहे हैं। आज देश का आम किसान, अन्नदाता, किसी एक विशेष पार्टी से नहीं जुड़ा, वो अपने हितों की रक्षा कर रहा है।
संख्या ज्यादा है मृतकों की और आंख मिचोली कर रहे हैं, पहले 10 लाख, फिर 1 करोड़, यानी किसी तरह से भी किसान के मुद्दों को दबाना चाहते हैं।
कांग्रेस वाइस प्रेसिडेंट राहुल गांधी एंड जेडीयू लीडर शरद यादव आर लाइकली टू विजिट मंदसौर टुडे टू मीट द किन ऑफ दोज किल्ड इन द वायलेंस ऑन ट्यूसडे। कंसिडरिंग द टेंशंस प्रिवेलिंग देयर, रेल ट्रैफिक थ्रू मंदसौर स्टेशन ऑल्सो केम टू अ हॉल्ट। ब्यूरो रिपोर्ट, राज्यसभा टीवी।
मीनवाइल, एज फार्मर्स प्रोटेस्ट इन महाराष्ट्र एंटर्ड इट्स सेवेंथ डे ऑन वेडनेसडे, soaring prices of vegetables and fruits in Mumbai and some other cities are slowly getting stabilized with increased inflow of agricultural produce. A state convention of farmers has been called in Nasik today. The meeting has been convened by Kisan Kranti Morcha. As per the reports, substantial inflow of vegetables and fruits in Pune, Navi Mumbai and Vashi agricultural produce market committees have stabilized their prices. Days after business remained subdued due to protest and shortage of supply, the Nasik APMC received 64 quintals of vegetables. Meanwhile, the Shiv Sena boycotted a cabinet meeting called by Chief Minister Devendra Fadnavis on Wednesday. The party instead sought a clarification from Fadnavis over the farm loan waiver issue. Sena President Uddhav Thackeray ridiculed the government's offer of holding talks only with true farmer leaders.
कर्ज माफी की जो योजना तैयार होगी उसमें शिवसेना को साथ में लेकर ही बातें हम मंजूर कर सकते हैं। शिवसेना के पक्ष प्रमुख उद्धव जी ठाकरे की जानकारी बिना कोई बात नहीं हो सकती। हम उनकी जो सम्मति है वो लेकर के आगे जाएंगे।
On some more news, 23 workers were charged to death and 7 others injured after fire broke out in a cracker factory in Balaghat district of Madhya Pradesh. The blaze started around 7:03 p.m. on Wednesday in the factory. According to Balaghat authorities, out of 10 workers injured in the incident initially, 3 died on their way to Nagpur. Chief Minister Shivraj Singh Chauhan has announced a compensation of 2 lakh rupees each to the next of the kin of the deceased. The state government would also bear the medical expenses of the injured. Meanwhile, a magisterial inquiry has been ordered into the incident.
सेफ्टी के उपाय थे कि नहीं, कितने मजदूर लगा सकते थे, सारे सुरक्षा के प्रबंध थे कि नहीं, और जितने की इनको विस्फोटक रखने की अनुमति थी उतने था कि ज़्यादा था, ये जांच के विषय हैं। तो जांच के बाद
जब 3:30 बजे की घटना विस्फोट हुआ है, किस प्रकार से विस्फोट हुआ, जो घायल लोग हैं उनसे पूछताछ करके दर्ज करेंगे।
In Assam, over 1 lakh people were affected by floods in Lakhimpur and Karimganj districts, while 4 rivers are flowing above the danger mark across the state. As per the Assam State Disaster Management Authority, over 1 lakh people are reeling due to the floods in the 2 districts, whereas 140 villages are underwater. Karimganj is the worst affected with nearly over 97,000 people, while more than 4,500 people were hit in Lakhimpur. Currently, 4 rivers are flowing above the danger mark across the state, including Dhansiri, Barak, Katahal and Khushiara. The calamity has damaged crops in close to 400 hectares of land. Meanwhile, in the capital Delhi, it got some respite from the scorching heat after light rains accompanied with winds lowered the temperature considerably. IMD has also predicted 98% rainfall forecast over the northwest India, including Uttar Pradesh, Haryana and Delhi.
Situation in Assam ab tak pura control mein hai. 3 district, the Lakhimpur, Karimganj and Dorong, these are the 3 district. Thoda kuch area unka affected hua hai. Total 92 villages of the 3 districts affected. And already 1 relief camp has been opened. There is a small relief camp. And so far landslide is not there. Dima Assam mein thoda kuch landslide ho raha hai.
Etia jitu ban dile ei ban tu karone etia etu pani beshi hoyse na hole agor pora pani hoy thake yat kintu yatke kom hoy etia ei bochor beshi hoyse.
And with that we'll slip into a very short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us.
अगर बायलैटरल क्रिकेट टाइज नामुमकिन है तो मल्टीलैटरल इवेंट्स खेलने का क्या मतलब है?
आतंकवाद और खेल साथ साथ नहीं चलता।
कॉन्फ्लिक्ट ऑफ इंटरेस्ट एक बहुत बड़ा इशू है, और जिस तरह से क्रिकेटर्स पैसे बना रहे हैं उन इश्यूज को अभी तक किसी ने डील नहीं किया है।
उसके ऊपर सुप्रीम कोर्ट पहले ही बैठी हुई है। मेरा रिएक्ट करना, मैं नहीं समझता कोई नई बात होगी।
देयर इज एन इंप्रेशन दैट ऑल इज नॉट वेल बिटवीन यू एंड मिस्टर मनोज तिवारी।
कुछ गलतफहमी हुई थी वो दूर हो गई है। तो ऐसा तो हो जाता है, परिवार में भी हो जाता है, बाहर भी हो जाता है।
Watch To The Point with Minister of State for Youth Affairs and Sports Vijay Goyal only on Rajya Sabha Television.
Welcome back. North Korea launched a series of what appeared to be surface-to-ship missiles today. According to South Korea's Defense Ministry, the launch took place from the vicinity of Wonsan, Gangwon Province. It would be the 4th missile test by the nuclear-armed regime in less than 5 weeks, as the Pyongyang continues to defy UN warnings and US threats of possible military action. The United Nations Security Council last Friday unanimously adopted a US drafted resolution imposing new sanctions on a handful of North Korean officials and entities in response to a series of ballistic missile tests this year that are banned under the UN resolutions. Early last month, the North test fired what appeared to be its longest range ballistic missile yet tested in a bid to bring the US mainland within the reach. The US military has said that it has successfully intercepted an intercontinental ballistic missile target in a test conducted amid concerns over the North's weapons program. Millions of people will be casting their vote in the UK general elections today. Polls will open at more than 40,000 polling stations across the country, with counting starting once voting ends on Friday. Around 50 million Britons are eligible to vote in the general elections, which is being held against the backdrop of two terror attacks. This is up from the last general elections in 2015, when there were 46.4 million registered voters. For the election to produce a majority government, the biggest party theoretically must win at least 326 seats of the 650 regional constituencies. Most polling stations are in schools, community centres and parish halls. Meanwhile, Parliament was officially dissolved on May 2nd after Prime Minister Theresa May decided to call snap polls.
I think he has a faint chance, but I still predict Theresa May has a probably get a majority of 50 or so. But who knows? I mean, the polls are all over the place. This latest security, this latest terrorist attack, who knows where that plays to Corbyn's advantage or Theresa May's?
I think Theresa May's got a bit of a shock. I think she assumed that if she played on personalities that compared to Corbyn, she would be a shoo-in. And I think actually Corbyn has run a surprisingly competent campaign.
I don't know, with the two leaders, it's a bit of a best of a bad bunch, really. I think Theresa May is a difficult one because obviously I'm only going to talk about Theresa and Corbyn because I think they're the only two that are in the runners. She's had a bit of a difficult job. This is her chance, I suppose, to be elected in, but even so, it's a short notice, I don't know. As for Corbyn, he doesn't really do it for me.
The question is, who do you trust to have the strong and stable leadership to get the best deal for Britain in Europe? Because Brexit matters. It is the basis for everything else.
And as we now prepare for government, we can already say we've changed that debate. And given people hope, hope it doesn't have to be like this. Inequality can and will be tackled. That austerity can be ended, that we can stand up to the elites and to the cynics, hope that we can give our health service, our schools, our police, our social care the money they need and deserve and need it now.
Capital city of Iran, Tehran, was attacked in a first ever assault by the terrorist organization Islamic State today. At least 12 people were killed and over 30 injured in twin suicide attacks on the parliament and on the landmark shrine of the founder of the Islamic Republic, Atiullah Ruhollah Khomeini.
Video showing the moment a suicide bomber detonated an explosive vest near the shrine of the Islamic Republic's founder, Ayatollah Khomeini. This after bombers and gunmen attacked the Iranian parliament and the mausoleum in Tehran.
بسته بودم به رگبار فقط می زدن اینا دیگه من از ساعت 10:30 تا 11 و 11 اینا فکر کنم.
The Islamic State claimed responsibility for the attack. Iran's supreme leader Ayatollah Ali Khamenei shrugged off the attacks, saying these firecrackers will not have the slightest effect on the will of the people. President Hassan Rouhani called for global unity against violent extremism.
تمام مجلس شورای اسلامی رو مصرفانه عزیز ایران تسلیت عرض می‌کنم حتما این اقدام اراده مردم ما برای مقابله با تروریسم رو تقویت خواهد کرد و همه مردم ایران مسلح و مردم ما در برابر این خطر عمومی مقابله خواهند کرد من قبل از این اتفاق عازمه
The assaults began mid-morning on Wednesday when four gunmen burst into the parliament complex, killing a guard and one other person. One eventually exploded a suicide vest while the others were killed by security forces. At roughly the same time, two assailants entered the grounds of the Khomeini Mausoleum, killing a gardener and wounding several other people. One detonated a suicide vest, while the other was shot dead. The standoff lasted around 5 hours before all the gunmen holed up in parliamentary office buildings were killed.
و بعد از اینکه نمایندگان محترم هم در این مسیر و آرامش کارشون رو ادامه دادن تشکر میکنم مسئله جزئی است ولی خب این نشون میده تروریست ها دنبال مسئله سازی هستن و مخصوصا ایران که یک قطب فعال و مؤثر در مبارزه با تروریسم هست.
The country's powerful revolutionary guards vowed revenge and claimed the United States and Saudi Arabia were involved. The US, on the other hand, condemned the attack and said that depravity of terrorism has no place in the world. But despite the attacks, the US Senate voted to move ahead on imposing new sanctions on Iran, including on its elite revolutionary guards. The UN, too, condemned the attack.
The Secretary General hopes those responsible for this unjustifiable violence will be swiftly brought to justice. All countries must work together in fighting terrorism while upholding the universal rights and values that bind the global community.
Moscow said the continuation of a series of terror attacks again underlines the need for coordinated actions in the fight against terror and IS. Indian Foreign Minister Sushma Swaraj spoke to her Iranian counterpart and offered sincere condolences on the loss of innocent lives and expressed solidarity with the people and the government of Iran. This is the most serious terrorist violence in Tehran since the 1979 Islamic Revolution. Despite Iran's active involvement in fighting the Islamic State in both Iraq and Syria, the Sunni group has not so far carried out any attacks inside Iran. Further, it appears to have little support in this predominantly Shia country. However, the ISIS published a rare video in Persian in March, warning it will conquer Iran and restore it to the Sunni Muslim nation as it was before. Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
On to some more international news. Fired FBI Director James Comey aimed a dagger blow at Donald Trump on Wednesday, saying the president repeatedly pressured him to publicly declare that he was not under investigation. Comey released his opening statement ahead of an appearance on Capitol Hill over an inquiry into the Russian interference in the U.S. presidential poll. The statement said that Trump had demanded his loyalty and asked him to drop a probe into ex-National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. Comey will tell Congress today that Donald Trump wanted a patronage relationship to national security officials. NSA Director Mike Rogers and Director of National Intelligence Dan Coats earlier testified to senators that they never felt pressured by the White House to do anything illegal. But in today's Senate Intelligence Committee hearing, Comey will detail how Trump made him uncomfortable during a series of encounters leading up to the FBI director's firing on 9th May. The testimony appears to bolster the case of Trump critics who believe that the president may have obstructed justice and abused his power in his dealings with Comey, who he later fired.
When it comes to Comey's statement, much of what he has put in the statement had already been leaked to the press, that we already knew about, that there are plenty of uncomfortable moments between the FBI director and President Trump. I don't think that there's a smoking gun in these documents that says that Trump has violated the law, but there's plenty here for Congress to ask about during the hearing.
And at the French Open, India's Rohan Bopanna and his Canadian partner Gabriela Dabrowski entered the final in the mixed doubles event. The seventh seeded duo of Bopanna Dabrowski defeated Andrea Lavakova and Edward Roger Willison 7-5, 6-3 in the semi-final match. In the Indo-Canadian pair will now play their title match against the pair of Robert Farah and Anna-Lena Grönefeld. In the men's single, Dominic Thiem stunned defending champion Novak Djokovic to set up a semi-final clash against Rafael Nadal. Sixth seed Thiem blasted 38 winners in his 7-6, 6-3, 6-0 victory over the world number two. Nine-times champion Nadal, on the other hand, got entry into the last four after the fellow Spaniard Pablo Carreño Busta quit with an injury. In other quarterfinals, Andy Murray reached his fourth consecutive French Open semi-final with a four-set win over Kei Nishikori. The world number one came through 2-6, 6-1, 7-6, 6-1 against the Japanese 8th seed. Murray will now face Swiss 3rd seed Stan Wawrinka, who beat Marin Cilic 6-3, 6-3, 6-1 to reach the last four. In the women's singles, 3rd seed Simona Halep saved a match point before going on to beat Elena Svitolina 3-6, 7-6, 6-0 in the quarterfinals. Halep will play Carolina Pliskova in the last four after the 2nd seed beat Caroline Garcia 7-6, 6-4 in the other quarterfinals. In the Champions Trophy, Pakistan beat South Africa by 19 runs on the Duckworth-Lewis method in the rain-affected match at the Edgbaston. In a superb bowling display, Pakistan reduced the world number one side to 118 for 6 before David Miller's 75 not out helped Proteas to reach 219 for 8 in their 50 overs. In reply, Pakistan were 119 for 3 after 27 overs when the rain stopped the play. The win reignites Pakistan's semi-final hopes and opens up Group B with all four teams in the fray for the semi-finals. India, meanwhile, will have a strong chance to reaching the semi-finals if they beat Sri Lanka in today's encounter at the Oval. The defending champions had thrashed Pakistan in their opening game and will look to continue their good performance in today's game as well. For Sri Lanka, it is a must-win game to keep their semi-final hopes alive. They had lost their opening encounter against South Africa by 96 runs.
We try to maintain the same kind of intensity and momentum, regardless of how we are playing. But yes, at the moment we are playing good cricket, but that doesn't mean that we play with arrogance as a team. You know, we respect every opposition the same way, and we intend to play the same kind of cricket against everyone.
And that's all we have for you in this edition of Breakfast News. Keep watching Rajya Sabha Television.